tuned in to Radio Gold. As you no doubt recall from the first half of our story, John Steed and Emma Peel find themselves in the proverbial pickle, as this perfectly perplexing puzzle leads them further down the path to personal peril. Stay tuned for the conclusion of our dramatic tale with the Avengers.
Now, from the makers of Coldwater Omo,
in the dark cellar of a special administration building at St. Catherine's, the Brigadier and Major Parsons were disturbed in their work and startled by Sergeant Hearn, who entered with unseemly haste, tore across the floor, almost forgetting the soldierly formalities, and skidded to a stop in front of them. He just remembered to throw a salute before he said,
"Intruders in the area, sir. Unauthorized. Two men. Got away, sir."
"Got away?"
"Report, sir."
"And make it coherent."
"Yes, sir. Two unauthorized men, sir. Stole a vehicle, sir."
"Well, they can't get very far that way. All roads are blocked. Which way were they headed?"
"I'm not sure, sir. I think they went to the northern part of the town."
"Know who they were?"
"One man's name is Steed. The other, Merlin."
"Merlin? That's all we need, a blasted sorcerer. Major!"
"Sir?"
"You had better handle this. A full platoon."
"Yes, sir."
"Now, use method in tracking them. Cross-plot the entire area and comb every inch."
"Yes, sir. Do you want them alive for questioning, sir?"
"I most certainly do not. Shoot them. And after a proper firing squad has been convened, that's the way to deal with them. Give them a fair trial and shoot them."
The Avengers. John Steed and Emma Peel, The Avengers. Coldwater Omo has really powerful cleaning action. Mrs. Senior discovered this.
"My husband wears overalls to work, and they come back very sort of greasy and dirty. My girl actually does them by hand in the tub, but she uses Coldwater Omo, and they're fine, and they come up perfectly clean."
"They say once an Omo user, always an Omo user?"
"I've stuck to Coldwater Omo, and I'm still using it. It's the strongest washing powder I've used."
"Coldwater Omo cleans best.
Keep your complexion soft and young-looking with the creamy, moisturizing lather of Lux. Like Claudia Cardinale, choose Lux. Lux, a beauty treatment as you bathe."
This story, in which John Steed and Jimmy Merlin find themselves an ally, but still can't unravel the mystery of what's going on in St. Catherine's the morning after. John Steed was determined. He'd found Jimmy Merlin, and regardless of what was going on, he wasn't going to release him. Admittedly, this was a severe setback. He wasn't sure when Merlin would try to make a break for it. It meant watching him and whatever was round the next corner. And driving the armored car was difficult with only one hand. Steed decided to park the thing.
"What's the idea? I'd hoped you were going to get us out of here."
"I've told you. I'm not leaving Mrs. Peel." "Be realistic, Merlin. If this whole town is under martial law, they'll have barriers up on all the roads out of it."
"I suppose that's true. But look, Steed, I'm your prisoner, right?"
"Right."
"And I'm your responsibility, right?"
"Right."
"Then you're supposed to take care of me, right?"
"Wrong."
But the rules say..."
"There are no rules in this business, Merlin. You should know that. Now, you want to find out what's going on, don't you?"
"No."
Well, there you are, then. Come on.
Steed dragged Merlin out of the parked car. They walked stealthily down the street and round the corner. There, not more than a few yards away, was a radio van, the one they'd seen earlier. The round, circular aerial had stopped revolving. This made Steed wonder if there was anyone in the van. He pulled Merlin forward.
I'm going to try the rear doors.
Steed reached the van, grasped the rear door handle, and jerked it open.
Oh, well, you might have knocked.
What's up, miss? Shall I clobber him?
Yates, a stocky young cockney, jumped from the van and approached Steed and Merlin. He held a large, heavy spanner in one hand.
No, no good. It's a fair cop. I suppose it isn't any use asking you two not to destroy the film. Remember, it is more than a scoop, it's history. Confiscate it if you want. Lock it away, but please don't destroy it. After all, I could put this in the...
The girl stopped. She noticed the handcuffs that linked Steed and Merlin together.
What on earth's going on here?
I wish someone would tell us.
You mean you honestly don't know?
No idea.
Do, miss.
You know, Yates, I think they're telling the truth. But it's fantastic.
It's not that fantastic. We've been knocked out for nearly 24 hours. Whatever has happened here at St. Catherine's happened then.
And we missed it. Why, it's still incredible that you don't know. The whole world knows.
I do hate to think that the whole world has me at a disadvantage.
I won't tell you what's happened. I can do better than that. I can show it to you. Climb into the van.
No.
It's all right. This is no trickery. I'm on the level.
All right. Come on, Merlin.
It was tiny and cramped inside the van. Yates moved to a TV monitor at the far end and began flicking switches.
I'm Jenny Thurston, by the way. Television News. We came in to cover the event, and then when everyone was ordered out of the area...
Well, we stayed on. Against orders, of course. We've been sneaking around the streets, picking up what shots we can. Okay, miss. Ready for the playback? Switch it on.
Right. This is the newscast you would have seen if you hadn't been asleep all day yesterday.
This is Jenny Thurston. I'm standing here in the heart of St. Catherine's. Cars are still pouring out of the town in their thousands. But jams are building up, and already owners are abandoning the private vehicles and hurrying away to the special coaches standing by for evacuation.
It was difficult for me to do this commentary. So much was going on.
Special troops. Thank you. Into the town. A state of emergency has been proclaimed. Within 30 minutes, this town and the surrounding 50 square miles surrounding it will be evacuated. It will become a ghost area. Empty, save for the troops. The area is under martial law as from now. Ah, here you see the man who will remain in sole command. Brigadier Hanson.
Oh, Hanson's
a... Look at those troops, Strickland! Easy there, man!
Yes, miss, what is it?
Television News. Brigadier, are you satisfied that everyone has been warned to leave the area?
We've called on everyone. Yes, I'm satisfied.
And how do you feel about staying on?
I'm a soldier. I have a duty.
Clear that truck! Get moving there, man! We've orders arriving! Move!
What I would like to stress to the nation is that there is no need to panic. We have everything under control. We know what we must do, and we shall do it. Excuse me.
You man, move that truck!
He knows what he must do.
Get that train down!
Brave words from a brave man.
Gently,
and there is the commission building. In there lies the task he must tackle. And the whole world will be waiting with bated breath to see the outcome of that task. If he succeeds, a royal welcome awaits him. If he fails, then he, his troops, this town, the countryside for 50 miles or more, will cease to exist.
Frightening, isn't it?
The Eastern Hemisphere Trade Commission building. It was vacated recently, but its occupants left behind them a monster buried deep in the cellar. They left behind the atom bomb, which Brigadier Hansing and his men must attempt to defuse at once. And now I think we should pass on to the crowds and ask their opinion. The men over there for the coach.
All right, Yates, that's enough. Kill it.
Yes, miss.
An atom bomb. But why? Who?
No one's sure. The Trade Commission building was occupied by representatives of more than 20 countries. Your guess is as good as mine.
A hostile warhead deep in the middle of our own territory.
Nice ace to have up one sleeve.
How was it discovered?
Pure fluke. Brigadier Hansen's one of the nuclear experts. He was staging some maneuvers in this area. His instruments registered radioactivity. He pinpointed the bomb.
That explains a great deal.
I should have thought he explained everything.
So, Miss Thurston, you're here without authority, then?
Afraid so. If we're caught, they'll...
Shoot you.
Oh, I think a firm reproof would be more in order.
Don't kid yourself. We've already seen how trigger-happy they are. Firing squad's already been at work.
You've got to be joking.
I'm afraid not.
You mean they actually shot someone? Here, in an English country town?
There is a state of emergency.
Did you hear that, Yates? Come on, we can't miss this.
Right, miss?
No, better still. You stay inside here. These two can ride with me in the front and show me the way. You can tell me more about yourself as we drive.
I say, look here.
No arguing. This could make the biggest story we've ever done. Well, come on. No time to lose.
Jenny Thurston handled the vehicle with professional skill. She drove fast, but well, following Steed's vague instructions, and at the same time, listening to him explain why he was still handcuffed to Jimmy Merlin.
And so, I can't let this man go. You understand?
Sounds unbelievable to me.
No more unbelievable than what's happening to us at this moment.
No, I suppose not. It doesn't look criminal.
Don't be fooled by his looks and easy charm. They're very deceptive.
I say, I wish to the devil you wouldn't keep discussing me as though I wasn't here. It's very embarrassing.
I've only said nice things so far.
All the same, it's embarrassing. I notice you haven't asked to hear my side of things.
You haven't got a side of things. Anything you tell Jenny will be calculated to foul up her tasks. Forget him, Jenny.
Oh, I won't do that.
Thank you.
But I will be careful. It's round this corner, isn't it?
Steer the wheel.
Well, you've got to put up with it. You can't get out and walk.
Hey, look, up ahead. Soldier. Looks like a major.
It was Major Parsons. Alone, but with a drawn revolver.
What now?
Slow down. About time I made myself known to the authorities.
You sure that's safe?
Don't worry. I'd have probably been sent into the area anyway.
Hey, Major. I'm John Steed, security clearance KR5. Might be able to give you a hand.
No, don't stop! Come
on! Merlin suddenly stretched out a long leg and stabbed his foot over Jenny's foot on the accelerator. The van leapt forward. The wing caught the Major and sent him flying.
Drive on!
What the devil
do you think you're doing? You could have killed him. That I recognize him. That's no Major Steed. He's no Major. What? That man is not British. His name's Gregor Parninsky. A cutthroat, a pirate, a mercenary.
Are you sure?
I'm quite sure. That man lying back there in the road unconscious is Parninsky, a Russian agent. Figure that one out, Steed.
One last lurch, Sam Lacey finishes washing his dog in just 17 minutes, 45 seconds. Well done, Sam. Play any other sports?
I lift a pint of beer now and then.
You look very fresh, Sam. What deodorant do you use?
Shield for Sportsmen, of course.
Why?
It works.
Shield for Sportsmen deodorant won't stick, sting, or stain. In aerosol or roll-on, it's made to keep sportsmen cool and dry. Think what it can do for you.
Once an Omo user, always an Omo user, like Mrs. Bodington.
My wash is beautiful, and I'm very proud of it. There's nothing like cold water Omo.
No dirt can stand up to Omo.
Over 1 million housewives have proved it. It cleans best.
The Avengers. Listen every evening, Monday to Friday, to John Steed and Emma Peel, The Avengers. Brought to you by the makers of Coldwater Omo.
Let's take a short intermission. Nero Wolfe made his larger-than-life radio show debut on July 5, 1943. This intelligent detective show, based on the Rex Stout novels, proved to be a natural for classic radio. Throughout the show's run, Santos Ortega, Louis Van Ruten, Francis X. Bushman, and Sidney Greenstreet all filled the voluminous chair of Nero Wolfe. As well, a large assortment of actors played the part of every blonde's hero, Archie Goodwin. The Adventures of Nero Wolfe show remained popular on the airwaves in different versions for 8 years, from 1943 to 1951. Stay tuned. The penultimate episode starts in a few seconds.
From the makers of Coldwater Omo.
Hey, look! Look up ahead! Soldier! Looks like a major.
Steed, Merlin, and Jenny Thurston, with Yates in the back of the van, were finding their way across the deserted town of St. Catharines. Ahead was a major. It was Major Parsons, alone, but with a drawn revolver.
Slow down. It's about time I made myself known to the authorities.
You sure that's safe?
Oh, don't worry.
Hey, Major, I'm John Steed, security clearance KR5. Might be able to give you a hand.
No, don't stop! No.
Merlin suddenly stretched out a long leg and stabbed his foot over Jenny's foot on the accelerator. The van leapt forward. The van caught the Major and sent him flying.
The devil you think you'll do, you could have killed him.
I recognize him. That isn't a British Major Steve. He isn't.
Ah, that man is not British.
His name is Parninsky. Gregor Parninsky. A cutthroat, a pirate, a mercenary, and a Russian agent. Figure that one out, Steve.
The Avengers. And Emma Peel, The Avengers. Once an Omo user, always an Omo user. This is what Mrs. Lyons of Yellowwood Park, Durban, has to say.
It is the one powder that does everything. Well, for me, I know that.
Yes?
There's so many things that I've used and experimented with just to prove cold water Omo, really to put to the ultimate test, you know, and I find that it's what come up to all my expectations.
Yes. Cold water Omo cleans best.
What's in the Moore's ice cream freezer today?
Ice cream?
Wild wafer. Wonder what's inside. Wow! Creamy strawberry and vanilla ice stuck together with munchy wafers. Wall's wow wafer. Wow!
Mm-hmm.
episode 5 of this story, in which John Steed returns to help the unconscious Mrs. Peel, but finds she's better off sleeping through the now disastrous events of the morning after. John Steed was a very puzzled man. He now knew that the reason the town of St. Catharines was deserted was because Brigadier Hanson's men had discovered that an atom bomb was concealed beneath the Trade Commission building. Once the bomb had been located in the dank, empty cellar, martial law had been proclaimed. Platoons of nuclear shock troops had been rushed to the area to help dismantle the bomb. Steed had been told all this by Jenny Thurston, a television news commentator who dared to stay on after the district had been evacuated. Jenny showed Steed and Merlin films of what had happened while they'd both been asleep. Steed, on his way back to Mrs. Peel in the TV van, thought he could give the troops a hand. That's why he had hailed the major. But Jimmy Merlin thought otherwise.
Merlin, you sure of this?
I'm quite sure.
You swerved the van, you might have killed him.
Many people have tried. He's a cat. He has more life than most.
Well, come, let's go and find out. Stay here with the eight, Jenny. We shan't be very long. Come on, Merlin.
Steed and Merlin clambered out of the van and walked hurriedly back to the unconscious form that lay near the car park.
All right, let's turn him over. There's
no doubt about it, Steed. That's Parninsky.
Let's search him. He may have identification.
Look, I don't care what cover he's got. I know this man.
Says here, Major Parsons, British Army. It's all correct papers.
Well, of course they're correct. He wouldn't be walking about this place with foreign papers on, would he? I tell you, it's him, Steed. It's Gregor Parninsky, and he's a foreign agent.
I haven't got proof of that.
You have my word.
As a double agent yourself, that doesn't count for very much.
Don't be a fool, Steed. It's because of my checkered past that I know all these people. Don't you see that? And in any case, why should I lie to you?
You are trickier than any wagon load of monkeys I've ever encountered. The sooner I contact the authorities and the sooner you're put away, the happier I'll be.
All right, have it your own way. I give up.
What's happened? Is this the man you thought it was, Jimmy?
Yes, it's him, all right. But Steve doesn't believe me because he's in uniform with the correct papers. But it's Parninsky, all right.
Is this possible?
Of course it's possible. Look, infiltrate, pose as an army officer. Any skilled agent who knew his business could do it blindfold.
It is possible, I admit. But if it's true...
Then he may not be the only one.
Well,
answer her, Steed. Tell her all about the firing squad. That's what's really been bothering you, hasn't it?
You mean the shooting of that man?
Yes. Steed doesn't believe that this country's got to that state, no matter what the emergency. Isn't that so, Steed?
Well, this is worrying, I agree.
A man was murdered, executed, shot, butchered in cold blood without a trial. Do you really think the British Army is now empowered to carry out such forms of shooting? Is this type of rough justice allowed? Well, Steed?
I admit that it doesn't fit in with all the other things I've been told.
It doesn't make sense to murder a man in cold blood without trial. Why didn't they just arrest him, ship him out of here as a criminal?
Well, someone may have taken the law into their own hands.
That sergeant who had a go at us?
Well, one thing is certain. We ought to let Brigadier Hanson know if he has any more soldiers like that on his staff.
And any more majors who are suspected agents.
Oh, you do what you like. I think we should just get out of here.
We can't run out. Can we, Steve?
I thought the situation was suddenly becoming simple and straightforward. No. Right, we'll go to Hanson.
Steve, every street is blocked off or patrolled. We'd never get near that building. We'd be taken prisoners and dealt with like that fellow Cartney.
We'll just have to keep our fingers crossed and hope we're lucky.
Lucky? But believe me, I'm just as confused as you are. But one thing I know, this is not going to be solved by luck. No, sir.
The three of them left the major where he was and bundled back into the van. Yates, inside, demanded to know what was going on, but it was all too complicated to explain. Jenny started the engine and skillfully backed the van.
I think there's a side road behind the church. If I take that, I can double back and approach the commission building from the other side. That should give us a better chance.
Just a minute, Jenny. I'd like to go to Barchester Street first.
Barchester Street? Where's that?
On the other side of town.
What? What for?
I left a friend there. I've been trying to get back to her for hours. Now that's where we're going and no arguments.
The Steed was a little late in this decision, for Sergeant Hearn and his troopers had been scouring the near neighborhood searching for them. They had entered the office building, and in the room marked the Poston Trading Company, they had found the sleeping form of Emma Peel. Sergeant Hearn looked down at her.
Well, what do you know? All right, men, relax.
The sergeant dropped down upon one knee and felt Mrs. Peel's pulse. Then he straightened up and moved to the table upon which lay Steed's briefcase. He snapped it open. He took from the case several papers and scrutinized them.
John Steed, the name of the joker who clobbered me. All right, men, stay out of sight. I have reason to think someone will be coming back to pick this woman up. After all, you can't blame them. I can only hope that Mr. John Steed gets here very soon.
Steed, Jimmy Merlin, Jenny, and Yates were actually on their way when...
Hold it. Look there, down that side road. Army trucks, quite a lot of them. Stop.
Don't go looking for trouble, Steve. We've got enough as it is.
Stop. I want to take a look at that lot. Might tell us something.
Jenny stayed at the wheel. Yates poked his head out of the back of the van, and they both watched as Steed and Merlin walked towards the army trucks. There was no one about. Jenny saw Steed jerk up the canvas drop that concealed the inside of the first truck and look inside. She saw him look swiftly at Merlin, and they moved to the next one. After completing the line, they hurried back.
What's happened?
How many men were sent in here for the emergency, Jenny?
Four platoons.
Four platoons of nuclear shock troops?
That's right. The best. What is it? What did you find over there?
Four platoons of nuclear shock troops. All drugged. All unconscious.
What? But if they're there, then...
Then who is out at the commission building? Who is handling that atom bomb?
At the commission building, Brigadier Hansen was confronting a very distressed Major Parsons. The Major, who'd come round in the street, had staggered back and blurted out an incoherent account of how he was knocked over.
You are a fool, Major.
Yes, sir.
More than that, you are a dangerous fool. Your incompetence could jeopardize the whole operation here.
Yes, sir.
If these people were to contact the outside world...
No, they can't do that, sir. The phones are out of action, and we're jamming all radio signals.
It seems to me that they might just walk out of the area. After all, it appears they can walk the streets with complete impunity.
I was taken by surprise, sir.
Offer me excuses! When your people approached me, they promised me professionals, Major, professionals! Instead, I'm surrounded by rank amateurs. I want these people found, and I want them found immediately. That is an order.
The people in question had by this time arrived near the offices where Sergeant Hearn lay in wait for them. They parked the car, and all four of them walked carefully to the main entrance. There, Steed stopped and produced some keys.
I want your word of honor, Merlin.
Oh, taking these blasted things off at last, Steve.
Good. I'm only undoing the handcuffs because I think there'll be trouble.
Oh, you can rely on me, Steve. You have my word. That's better. You know, I'm touched. I'm really touched by your faith in me.
Don't be. I'm doing this because I don't want to find myself dragging around a dead man. Careful now. All right, Jenny, Yates?
Yes?
Right, Mr. Steed, lead the way.
Right.
In the upstairs room, Sergeant Hearn waved his troopers back into cover and waited. Mrs. Peel slumbered on.
Mrs. Peel?
Still sleeping.
Come in.
What now?
Well, I think we should get over to the commissioner's building.
Get out if you ask me.
Arno, stay where you are.
Take cover.
Steed dropped down to the floor, so did Jenny. Yates panicked.
I'm Johnny Al.
Shot him in the back. As he fell to the floor, Merlin moved like lightning. He hurled a trooper across the room. Made for the door, was through it in a flash, and slammed it behind him.
After him!
Stay where you are, Steed. One move and you're as dead as that man on the carpet. Both of you, hands above your head, right now!
dog gives you a lot of pleasure. Now, here's something you must do for him. Give him all new Procos health food for dogs. It's complete. New Procos contains all the energy-giving vitamins and protein a healthy dog needs. So with new Procos, you need feed him nothing else. New Procos health food is all he needs. Care for your dog. Give him new Procos health food for dogs. It's complete, and he'll love it.
They say once an Omo user, always an Omo user. Here's Mrs. Senior of Mbogan Tweeney.
I've stuck to cold water, Irma, and I'm still using it. It's the strongest washing powder I've used.
There's no dirt or stains that can stand up to cold water Omo.
The Avengers. Listen every evening, Monday to Friday, to John Steed and Emma Peel, The Avengers. Brought to you by the makers of Coldwater Omo.
Let's take a short intermission. San Francisco private detective Sam Spade takes on a case that involves him with three eccentric criminals: a gorgeous liar, a fat man, a foreigner, and their obsession to own a priceless statuette. With the stakes rising after his partner is murdered, the quest for the Black Bird consumes them all in this live radio adaptation of Dashiell Hammett's worldwide best-selling detective novel. In 1943, the Columbia Broadcasting System, Cecil B. DeMille, and the Lux Radio Theater entertained a wartime America by presenting Edward G. Robinson as Sam Spade in The Maltese Falcon. Stay tuned for the exciting conclusion of our Avenger adventure.
Now, from the makers of Coldwater Omo...
Yates! Yates! You killed him! Shot him down like an animal! Shot in the back!
Stay where you are, both of you! Don't move, Steed, or you'll be as dead as he is.
Merlin, he got away.
Yes, your friend wasn't feeling very brave, was he?
He always was a disappointment.
I've been looking forward to meeting you again, Steed. Pity Merlin got away, but at least I've got two of you.
Go ahead. Shoot.
It wouldn't be legal. So, you may sit down if you wish, but keep your hands up. The firing squad won't be long, and then, bang, bang. You won't have anything else to worry about, will you?
The Avengers. John Steed and Emma Peel, The Avengers. So many women say, once an Omo user, always an Omo user, because there's just no dirt that can stand up to the cleaning power of cold water Omo. It solves Mrs. Sutherland's washing problems for her.
Very dirty oil or grease marks.
Yes.
If you use cold water Omo, there's no trouble at all. It comes out very, very easily indeed.
There's no washing problem too difficult for cold water Omo. Over 1 million South African housewives have proved it.
Beautiful Jill St. John knows the value of the creamy, moisturizing lather of Lux. Choose Lux to keep your skin soft and smooth. Lux, a beauty treatment as you bathe. Episode 6, the final episode in this story, in which Emma Peel wakes up at last, and John Steed manages to straighten out all the puzzling activities that have been taking place during the morning after. John Steed, Jimmy Mervin, Jenny Thurston, and her driver Yates fell neatly into the trap Sergeant Hearn had set for them. They'd returned to the offices of the Poston Trading Company to find Mrs. Peel. Mrs. Peel was still there, all right, and still fast asleep. But Hearn and his men were there, too. Hearn had shot Yates as he was attempting a getaway. But Jimmy Mervin was luckier and made his escape among a flurry of gunshots. Hearn's men had given chase, firing blindly, but Merlin had a good start and dodged in and out of alleyways, heading for the car park.
At the same time, I must get to my car. That's the first thing. Not much further now.
Merlin doubled back, tore down a side road, and into the car park. Once there, it was easy to conceal himself and wriggle his way to where his own car stood. He froze as voices approached.
He went this way, headed into the car park.
I don't think so. He went around the back over there.
Merlin dropped to the ground and squeezed himself under his car. He saw army boots approach, heard voices, foreign voices.
We must not fail. If we do, it will not go well with us.
He could have made for the other entrance and the exit over there.
Merlin waited until the footsteps had died away and then scrambled from under the car, unlocked the door, and sank with a sigh of relief into the driver's seat. He inserted the key in the ignition, and then a thoughtful look came over his face. He reached back under the seat and withdrew a small suitcase marked J. Merlin. He opened it, peered inside, seemed pleased with what he saw, closed the case, and then made a decision. With a broad smile, he opened the car door and, carrying the case, weaved his way silently amongst the cars, heading back the way he'd come, back to the Poston Trading Company. Back in those offices, Steed was doing a bit of deep thinking.
Harold Courtney.
What? What's that, Steed?
What are you talking about, Steed? No, keep your hands up.
The man you shot, Harold Courtney. I thought I knew the name. He was a member of the Nuclear Fission Committee. Atom bomb expert. Now, why should he stay on in the area?
Curiosity?
That, or he sensed something was wrong. The area cleared and fake troops move in.
But what about the team who are dismantling the bomb?
Dismantling it? Are they?
You cotton on fast, Steed. We're not taking the bomb apart. We're putting it together.
What? You're building a bomb?
It makes a sort of twisted sense, doesn't it, Jenny? The area is declared clear. Everyone moves back in, and then...
Then the government pays up. We make our demand, pay up, or else...
And in the commission building, the brigadier was pacing to and fro in the cellar.
Well, how's it going, Major?
Nearly finished, sir. The crew are just putting the finishing touches to the installation. They'll screw the large metal plate into position as a cover, and then all is ready.
Well, hurry it up. We're nearly all ready. And when we are... Yes. When we are, I shall personally issue the ultimatum. I should like to see their faces when they hear how Brigadier Montague Hanson has outwitted them at last.
Jenny Thurston had never been in such a frightening position, but she refused to be cowed by the burly sergeant who had a gun pointed at her and John Steed.
Tell me something, Sergeant. A purely professional question from a newswoman. Who exactly are you?
We might say that we are all mercenaries. Quite cleverly directed mercenaries. The plan was so simple. We declared a state of emergency. They cleared the area to allow us to bring our apparatus in. They assisted us, in fact. Now, well, everyone believes we're heroes. That gives our demand more weight.
What do you mean, more weight?
This is a dummy run, Jenny.
You catch on fast, Steed. It took a long time to evacuate the area. A long time. And the authorities know that.
I still don't understand.
Once the bomb is installed and ready to trigger off, you'll sound the all clear. Isn't that right?
Correct.
The people will come back, pouring back into their homes all over this area.
And when they are here, every one of them home, that's when we tell them to pay up. We'll give them just 15 minutes to hand over 20 millions.
And if they don't, you'll detonate the bomb?
They'll pay up.
They already know how long it took to clear the area.
A lot longer than 15 minutes. 20 millions. That'll mean there'll be a cut for everyone. Not all equal, you understand. The Brigadier will get the lion's share.
The Brigadier? A man of his standing involved in a thing like this? Why? Why and how?
Peak. Anyway, that's what the other chaps say. Peak. Bitterness. Anger. He's been told he's going to be replaced, made redundant, by a computer. A machine. It's a lot for a man of his experience to swallow. Kicked out of the service to make room for a machine. Of course, the money's a big incentive, too. But it's the machine bit that really gets him. Oh, well, I think we've waited long enough. Come on your feet. We'll find them.
I think we should make up your mind.
I have. I don't suppose you've got any preference where your execution takes place.
What? Why don't you get it over with?
Outside, then. Quickly. Come along there.
At that moment, several things happened at once. Steed stepped between Hearn and Jenny. Mrs. Peel woke up at last, and the door opened.
What's going on?
Stay where you are.
Hands off. No, 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 no.
What the devil?
Mrs. Peel, wide awake in a second, took in the situation at a glance, shot forward, collared Hearn and threw him across the room just as Jimmy Merlin appeared in the doorway with another gas capsule. Steed's warning came too late. The capsule spun out of Merlin's hand and broke on the floor, right under Mrs. Peel's nose. Mrs. Peel gave a smile of triumph, appealed to Steed for approval, and never reached the end of the sentence.
How was that, Steed? Did I help you out of a little...
Quick, get out. Get out of here. Out, Jenny. Norrin, out!
Sorry, Steed. I thought I was doing the right thing.
I thought I'd seen the last of you.
I couldn't do that. Bad for business. You might have spit it around that I was unreliable. Besides, it seemed a shame not to put those capsules to good use.
You had more than one. You were intent on selling the exclusive rights to as many people as possible.
You know me, Steed. Cautious. Do you blame me?
You got more in there?
Oh, yes, but... Hey, yeah.
I'm confiscating them. Jenny, you stay here. Keep an eye on this room and don't go in, for heaven's sake. Guard it here.
Right. Where are you off to?
The commission building.
Oh, now, look here, Steed. Look, I've done my Boy Scout bit.
Come on, Merlin. You gave me your word.
Oh, that's before I knew you were intent on murder. My murder.
I need you, Merlin. I'm depending on you.
But you know me. I'm probably the most undependable person in the Western Hemisphere.
You came back.
I told you why.
You didn't want me to spread rumors about you. I couldn't have done that if I were dead. So you saved my life for what?
You're trying to blind me with semantics. All right, point me towards the jaws of death. Let's get going.
In the cellar of the commission building, Brigadier Hansen had finished all his preparations.
Excellent. Excellent, Major. It'll take him more than an hour to cut through that lot. And they won't have that much time. All right. Let's clear up and get out of here.
The men were all ready to leave the cellar when Steed and Merlin appeared at the top of the stairs.
Just in time, it seems, Merlin.
Let's give him one to start with.
Take cover, men! Take cover! Open fire there at the top of the stairs!
Two or three more should lay enough for days.
Cover your face, Steve. There's enough gas down here to knock up.
Right.
Hey, listen.
Hmm? A short time later, back at the Poston Trading Co. offices.
Well, what happened, Steed?
Unless our friends walk in their sleep, it's all over, Jenny.
I've got to get back with this story. Anyone coming with me?
I suppose you'd better get out my handcuffs again, Steve.
Jimmy, if I don't, will you promise me to stay out of trouble?
You have my word as an honest man. Thanks, Steed. I won't forget this. Thanks a lot. Come on, Jenny, let's get to know each other a little better. Bye, Steed.
Bye, Steed.
Goodbye. Oh, no. Au revoir. Mrs. Peel. Mrs. Peel.
Oh. I feel as though I've slept for a week. Hello, Steed. Anything exciting happening yet?
No. All peaceful. Come on, let's get out of here.
And with a vicious uppercut, Jimmy Anderson finishes trimming his whole hedge in just 3 hours, 11 minutes. Great work, Jimmy. Do you play any other sport?
Yes, dominoes.
You're looking pretty cool, Jimmy. What deodorant do you use?
Shield for Sportsmen, of course.
Why?
It works.
Shield for Sportsmen deodorant won't stick, sting, or stain. In aerosol or roll-on, it's made to keep sportsmen cool and dry. Think what it can do for you.
So many women tell us that once an Omo user, always an Omo user. Women like Mrs. Clark of East London.
This is certainly the one that I've stuck to. And it's all I get now.
Yes, Goldwater Omo cleans best. Over 1 million housewives have proved it.
The Avengers.
Listen every evening, Monday to Friday, to John Steed and Emma Peel, The Avengers. Brought to you by the makers of Coldwater Omo. The Avengers. Donald Monat as John Steed and Diane Appleby as Emma Peel is adapted and directed by Dennis Faulbig and produced by David Gooden.
Radio Gold is a Three Nines Fine radio production. See you next time.